وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على عبد الله ورسوله نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome to another episode from this series based upon the statement of Allah Azza wa Jal, وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمُ ادْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ And your Lord said, call upon me and I will answer you. We're talking about dua and we have reached the episode which deals with Sayyidul Istighfar, the master of seeking forgiveness. عن شداد بن أوس رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال Shaddad ibn Aws radiallahu anhu narrated from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam that he said, Sayyidul istighfar an yaqulul abd, that the master of seeking forgiveness is for a servant to say, Allahumma anta rabbi la ilaha illa ant, khalaqtani wa ana abduk, wa ana ala ahdika wa wa'dika mastata't, a'udhu bika min sharri ma sana't. أبوء لك بنعمتك علي وأبوء بذنبي فاغفر لي فإنه لا يغفر الذنوب إلا أنت. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said about this dua, من قالها من النهار موقنا بها فمات من يومه قبل أن يمسي فهو من أهل الجنة ومن قالها من الليل وهو موقن بها فمات قبل أن يصبح فَهُوَ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ He said, whoever says this in the daytime with certainty in it and dies on that day before the evening comes, then they will be from the people of Jannah. And whoever says it in the nighttime and they are certain of it and they die before the morning comes, then they are from the people of Jannah. And in some of the riwayat, دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ That person will enter Jannah. And in some of the riwayat, illa wajabat lahu al-jannah, except that Jannah becomes obligatory for that person. This hadith was narrated by Imam al-Bukhari in his Sahih in the book of Dua, in the chapter Babu Afdal al-Istighfar, the best way of asking Allah's forgiveness. And likewise, he also narrated it again in Babu ma yaqulu idha asbah, what to say when the morning comes. So this dua is from the du'as and the adhkar that are said in the morning and the evening, what the scholars sometimes call amalul yawmi wal layla, the things you do every morning and the things you do every evening to say this du'a. Now this term Sayyidul Istighfar, this indicates to us that this particular form of the du'a is the most comprehensive and the best way of asking for Allah's forgiveness because of all of the things that it contains. And when we go through this dua, inshaAllah ta'ala, it will become clear the kind of humility, you know, presenting yourself as being broken before Allah. These are all things that we've spoken about in the etiquettes of dua, and they're also things that come into play in this particular dua, which is known as Sayyidul Istighfar, the dua which is the best kind of seeking forgiveness from Allah. So let's go through this dua step by step and piece by piece to appreciate the many different etiquettes of dua that exist within this Sayyidul Istighfar, the best way of asking for Allah's forgiveness. At the beginning, we say, Allahumma anta Rabbi. So first of all, this dua begins with the praise of Allah. And didn't we say one of the etiquettes of dua is to begin dua by praising Allah Azza wa Jal, and by mentioning his names and attributes, and it contains tawassul. It contains a form of seeking nearness to Allah through mentioning his names and attributes. The first name that is mentioned in this dua, Allahumma, O Allah, O Allah. And many of the scholars, as we said, they said that the word Allah, the name Allah, is Allah's greatest name. That is a mainstream opinion among many of the scholars of Islam, that the name Allah is Allah's greatest name. And therefore it begins with certainly one of the greatest names of Allah, if not the greatest names of Allah, Allah. And then likewise, It continues, Allahumma anta rabbi, you are my Lord. Now when we say anta rabbi, what do we benefit from this? First of all, we benefit from this that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is our Lord and He has all of the attributes of rububiyyah, of Lordship. He created us, sustains us. He is the one who gives life and causes death. He's the only one who answers, the one who is desperate and in desperate need, al-muttar, when they make dua. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who nurtures us, the one who looks after us, the one who guides us, the one who nurtures our iman. And all of those meanings come within the statement, Allahumma anta rabbi, O Allah, you are my Lord. Allahumma anta rabbi, la ilaha illa ant. O Allah, you are my Lord. There is no God worthy of worship but you. This is another kind of tawassul. So we said the first kind of tawassul we have in the dua is the tawassul with Allah's names, Allah and Ar-Rabb. And then now we have La ilaha illa ant. This is a kind of tawassul. First of all, you're praising Allah Azza wa Jal that nobody deserves to be worshipped but Him, but you're also affirming your own belief. And that is tawassul through your belief and tawassul through your good deeds. That, O Allah, I am asking you, believing that there is no God worthy of worship but you, practicing in my life that there is no God worthy of worship but you, meaning there is no one who can answer my dua but you, because you are a Rabb. And therefore there is no one that I will make dua to but you, because no one else has the attributes of rububiyyah that you have. And that's the link between ar-rububiyyah wal-uluhiyyah, between Allah's Lordship and between worshipping Allah. That we worship Allah Azza wa Jal alone and with no partner because of what Allah Azza wa Jal describes Himself with, of His excellent and perfect names and attributes and actions. Allah is the only one who creates. We only make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So from the point of view of Allah's actions, ar-rububiyyah, Allah is the only one who creates and sustains and provides and sends down rain and gives life and causes death. And from the point of view of our actions, we only make dua to Him and we only pray to Him, we only make sajda to Him, we only have love in our heart, that is the love that you have for Allah is only for Him, and so on and so forth. The trust that you have in Allah, the reliance you have upon Allah Azza wa Jal, all of these are only for Allah. قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِ وَنُسُكِ وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Say that my prayer and my sacrifice, my life and my death are for Allah, Lord of the worlds. So here we have the link between ar-rububiyyah wal-uluhiyyah, mentioning both of them. That Allah, you are my Rabb, you are my Lord, my creator, provider, sustainer, the one who gives life and causes death, the only one who answers dua. La ilaha illa ant, there is no God worthy of worship but you. Therefore all of my dua will be only for you. And all of my prayers will be only for you. And all of my sacrifice will only be for you, and so on. So this joins between the tawassul of Allah's names and attributes and the tawassul of the good deeds and good actions that you do. Allahumma anta rabbi la ilaha illa ant. And la ilaha illallah is one of the greatest things that you can use to come near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Khalaqtani, you created me. Wa ana abduk, and I am your slave. This contains the feeling of humility before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Khalaqtani, you created me, and I am your slave. And we know the slaves of Allah are of two categories. Those who are slaves of Allah, and that is everyone is a slave of Allah, whether they like it or not, everyone is a slave of Allah. However, there are some who choose to embrace that servitude, and there are those who turn away and fight against that servitude. Ultimately, whether they want it or not, all of them are slaves of Allah. All of them are slaves of Allah Azza wa Jal. This is the meaning that is found within the statement of Allah Azza wa Jal. In kullu man fi samawati wal ard illa ati ar-Rahmani abada. Everyone on the heavens and the earth comes to ar-Rahman as a slave. regardless of whether they have accepted that servitude and embraced it or not, all of them come before Allah Azza wa Jal as slaves. And yet there is an ubudiyah which is khas. There is a kind of slavery and servitude in which a person embraces that and submits to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Islam. And that is the servitude which is intended in this dua. Ana abduk. I am submitting to you in servitude, in worship. You created me and I recognize that I am a slave. And I embrace that and I submit to that. And I worship Allah Azza wa Jal in that way. So it contains an embracing of servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And likewise, it contains the humility and the being broken before Allah Azza wa Jal. A person presents themselves in a state of being broken. A person presents themselves in a state of humility, in a state of need. When someone says, خَلَقْتَنِي, you created me, O Allah. وَأَنَا عَبْدُكَ, I am your servant, I am your slave. And this contains that degree of servitude and that expression of need that we said are from the essential elements of dua and from the things that made dua, الدُّعَى هُوَ الْعِبَادَةِ, dua is ibadah because of that servitude that is found within it. And whenever we mention the creation of Allah Azza wa Jal, that Allah is the creator and that Allah Azza wa Jal is the sustainer and so on and so forth, that is to lead us to the worship of Allah Azza wa Jal, to lead us to recognize Allah's right to be worshipped. And that's really what is intended here. خَلَقْتَنِي وَأَنَا عَبْدُكَ, you created me and I recognize this, and therefore I recognize that it is my duty to submit to you in servitude. وَأَنَا عَبْدُكَ وَأَنَا عَلَىٰ عَهْدِكَ وَوَعْدِكَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتَ, and I am trying to stick to what you have required from me, my covenant with you and my promise that I made to you as much as I can. وَأَنَا عَلَىٰ عَهْدِكَ وَوَعْدِكَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتَ, and I am, or I have promised you and taken a covenant with you that I will try to adhere to the requirements of Iman and worshipping you and submitting to you as much as I can. As much as I can. And that there's indication in that all of us as human beings, we slip up. We all slip up. كُلُّ بَنِي آدَمَ خَطَّى, all of the children of Adam make mistakes. We all slip up. That's something that is in human nature. And the Prophet ﷺ indicated this when he said, استقيموا ولن تحصوا. Stand upright in Islam, but you'll not be able to achieve it perfectly. And his statement, سددوا وقاربوا, do the right thing and come close to it as much as you can. You won't be able to get everything 100% of the time. However, you do the best that you can. You try the best that you can. And you strive to do whatever you can to stick to the agreement and the covenant between you and between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَنَا عَلَىٰ عَهْدِكَ وَوَعْدِكَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتَ, I am standing firm upon what I have promised that I will do, the agreement that I have taken, and I'm holding on to it as much as possible. So Allah Azza wa Jalla has required from you Iman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has required from you various things that make up the religion, and you are trying to do as much as you can. بالاستطاعة, as much as you are able to do. That also contains an element of humility and submissiveness before Allah and presenting yourself as being broken to Allah. Because when you say مستطعت, you indicate العجز, you indicate your inability, and you indicate your weakness, al-da'f, and al-qusur, and the fact that you have shortcomings, that, oh Allah, I'm trying, but I know that I haven't brought Iman completely the way that you asked me to bring it. I know that I haven't brought all of the aspects of Iman the way that you told me to bring it perfectly. I have areas where I have fallen short. I have areas where I wasn't able to do something because my ability is limited and I am weak. So you present yourself as being weak. You present yourself as being in need of Allah. And you recognize that you are deserving of punishment. And this, subhanAllah, only is such a great benefit for a person to recognize that they are falling short. So many people, when they speak or when they look at themselves and they reflect upon themselves, they see that, well, I'm doing pretty much everything I need to do. How does that compare? وَأَنَا عَلَىٰ عَهْدِكَ وَوَعْدِكَ مَاسْتَطَعْتِ. I'm just trying to do whatever I can to stick to your agreement, recognizing that I haven't stuck to it and I have fallen short, and therefore I need this forgiveness. And that's an expression of need before Allah Azza wa Jal. وَأَنَا عَلَىٰ عَهْدِكَ وَوَعْدِكَ مَاسْتَطَعْتِ أَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنْ شَرِّ مَا صَنَعْتِ. I seek refuge with you from the evil of that which I have done. This contains again al-i'tiraf, a confession of your mistakes and your sins. And again, so important. When we say la ilaha illa ant, there is no God worthy of worship but you, this entails that you confess your sins to Allah, you don't confess your sins to anyone else. Look at the Christians and the priests and so on. When they go and they confess, the person goes to the priest and says, forgive me, Father, for I have sinned. Who gave that priest right to forgive you? Who said that you are not better than them or they are not better than you? But when in Islam, when you go and you confess your sins, you confess it to Allah Azza wa Jal. I seek refuge with you, O Allah, from the evil that I have done. From repeating that evil, from the consequences of that evil. And that's one of the meanings of istighfar. One of the core meanings of istighfar is to seek refuge with Allah from the consequences, to ask Allah to cover up the consequences of what will happen with that sin. Because sins have consequences. Sins have consequences upon you, upon your dunya, your akhirah, what happens to you, your guidance and misguidance. Sins have consequences. All of your sins have consequences. When you ask Allah that I seek refuge with you, oh Allah, protect me from the consequences of the evil that I have done. أَبُوءُ لَكَ بِنِعْمَتِكَ عَلَيْهِ وَأَبُوءُ بِذَنْبِي. This word أَبُوءُ, it means أَعْتَرِفُ وَأُقِرُّ. I confess and I admit to the blessings that you have given me. When a person recognizes the blessings, the minnah of Allah Azza wa Jal, how Allah has blessed you and how Allah Azza wa Jal has given you, and how Allah Azza wa Jal, even though you disobeyed Him, He kept on giving you. And even though you turned away from Him, He kept forgiving you. And even though you didn't do what He required from you, He still gave you another chance. And all of the other ni'am, who can say that they have thanked Allah for the blessings that He gave them? I confess to you, O Allah, the blessings that you have given me. I admit to them. I accept that you have given me all of these blessings. I don't deny them. I don't say that they came from me or my hard work or what I was deserving of or because I was so good. You gave me these blessings. Mahdu fadlillah. Nothing but the grace of Allah Azza wa Jalla, the pure grace of Allah, that these blessings came to me. Like Allah Azza wa Jalla said, وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ حَبَّبَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْإِيمَانِ وَزَيَّنَهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ وَكَرَّهَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْكُفْرَ وَالْفُسُوقَ وَالْعِسْيَانِ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الرَّاشِدُونَ فَضْلًا مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَنِعْمَهُ وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ. Allah has made Iman beloved to you. And He's made it something beautiful to your heart. And He's made you hate to disbelieve, to be disobedient, to be defiant. To be defiant or to be disobedient. They are the rightly guided. As a blessing from Allah and a grace. فَضْلًا مِّنَ اللَّهِ. As a grace from Allah and a ni'mah and a blessing. Meaning that this state of iman that you have is from the ni'mah of Allah, from the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From the blessings that Allah Azza wa Jal gave. Purely from those blessings. Purely from those blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you this iman. Not from something you deserve. So when you confess to that, it further increases your humility, that, oh Allah, you've given me so much, you've given me more than I could ever explain, and I haven't done what I was told to do with it. I haven't thanked you for every one of those blessings. the way that I was supposed to. So this confession implies that أَبُوءُ لَكَ بِنِعْمَتِكَ عَلَيْهِ وَأَبُوءُ بِذَنْبِي, and I confess to my sins. I confess to my sins. I confess to you the blessings that you have given to me. All of the blessings that can't be, the blessings that can't be counted. وَإِذْ تَأَذَّنَ رَبُّكُمْ لَإِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ وَلَإِنْ كَفَرْتُمْ إِنَّ عَذَابِي لَشَدِيدٌ. When your Lord declared that if you show gratitude, I will give you more. And if you show ingratitude, of which disbelief is the greatest example of ingratitude, then indeed my punishment is severe. So a person accepts the blessings that Allah Azza wa Jalla has given, and they accept the fact that they have sinned. وَأَبُوءُ بِذَنْبِي, I accept my sins, that I haven't shown gratitude for the blessings in the most complete way. That connects the two, that I haven't shown those blessings in the most complete way. The second meaning is that I confess that I have sins. So the first meaning is related to the ni'mah, the blessings, that I confess that I haven't shown gratitude for those blessings the way that I should have. And I confess to the presence of sins in my life, in my deeds. I confess to them. And this is so important to achieve that state of humility and brokenness before Allah, that you see that you have sins. You see your sins to be huge in the sight of Allah Azza wa Jalla, and you see your good deeds to be very, very small. And that leads to a person really humbling themselves before Allah Azza wa Jalla. And it's the reality at the end of the day. That is what we are. That is what human beings do. And then after all of that confession, فَغْفِرْ لِي, so forgive me. So forgive me. فَغْفِرْ لِي. And al-maghfira, asking Allah to forgive you, asking Allah to forgive you, is to ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to cover up the consequences of your sin. And as Allah Azza wa Jalla said, وَمَنْ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ, who is it that forgives sins except Allah Azza wa Jalla? And then you say, فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ, there is no one who forgives sins except for you. And that in itself, that statement that there is no one who forgives sins except for you, in itself is an indication or a cause for forgiveness. That's itself a cause for forgiveness for the person who knows that they have a Lord. أَنَّ لَهُ رَبًّا يَغْفِرُ الذَّنْبَ وَيَأْخُذُ بِالذَّنْبَ. They know that they have a Lord that forgives and a Lord that punishes. That Allah Azza wa Jal forgives and Allah Azza wa Jal can punish them. And they know that no one can forgive their sins except Allah Azza wa Jal. So in summary, what can we take from this dua? We can take from it affirmation that Allah Azza wa Jal alone is deserving of worship and servitude. We can take from this the admission that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Lord and the Creator. We can take from this the acceptance of the fact that there is a covenant between you and between Allah Azza wa Jal. We can take from this hope in what Allah Azza wa Jal has promised us when we perform the actions that we need to do. We can take from this seeking refuge from the evil of what a person does against themselves or does to themselves. We can take from this that blessings are to be attributed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who brought them into being and the one who gave them to whoever he wills subhanahu wa ta'ala. We can take from this that the sins that we do and the mistakes that we do come from us and they're our fault. And we can take from this a hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive us, and that no one is able to forgive sins except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is just a few of the points that make this dua from Sayyidul Istighfar, from the great or the greatest and the best of the ways of asking for Allah's forgiveness. That is what Allah Azza wa Jalla made easy for me to mention in this episode, and Allah Azza wa Jalla knows best. Wa salatu wa salam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. How can you do a 2-second action right now that will give you a share of the reward of everything we're doing on this YouTube channel? Simple. Like this video and click subscribe. Why? It will allow YouTube to recommend our videos to other users. And imagine the huge amount of reward that could be waiting for you on the Day of Judgment if you did that with a sincere intention of spreading the Deen of Allah. You'll be rewarded for every single person who benefits from one of our videos as a result of your like or subscribe. That's an easy 2-second action that you definitely don't want to miss out on. Do it now, click like and subscribe, and don't forget to make that intention.